Factory Backing has been producing custom motocross graphics since 2004. At Factory Backing, they prioritize quality by using the finest vinyl materials available. Their competitive prices might seem surprising, but rest assured, they offer top-notch products specifically designed for motocross and the demands of dirt bike riders. Check them out at factorybacking.com. But act fast, as they are celebrating their 20th anniversary with a 50% off sale. Everyone, welcome to the Midweek Podcast, presented by our friends at Factory Backing. Factory Backing, Kris, is a motocross custom graphic company that's celebrating its 20th year in business. I don't know how long you've been in business yet. But,
not that long, but that's a long time.
Yeah, but Jared Austin, he designs great designs for your motocross bike, quad, go-kart, anything you put stickers on. Factory Backing is your company. They have a 50% off sale going on right now because they're celebrating 20 years. So check them out at factorybacking.com. This is Kris Coan-Palm, my buddy who owns FCP, Factory Chassis Parts. And I like to call you the Swedish meatball because you are a you're an immigrant from good old Sweden. So the whole premise of the Midweek Podcast is to get someone's story, right? So you're a professional motocross racer from Sweden. You came here to race, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And,
yeah.
And you just never went home.
Yeah, yeah. So, we'll have to like fix the name a little bit because, yeah, it is Kris Coan-Palm now. Like, my wife and I hyphenated our names.
Whoa. Wait, what? Coan-Palm?
Coan.
Yeah. K-O-H-E-N?
C-O-A-N.
C-O-A-N.
Yeah.
You hyphenated your names.
Yeah, yeah.
Because she didn't want to give up her name.
Yeah. Yeah, kind of. Basically.
So you took her name also.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Dude, it's a new age, man. Life's different these days, so.
Was this a term of the citizenship? Maybe. You have to take my name?
Maybe. No, really what it was is she's taken over the family business, and it's Coan Construction. So,
okay,
so when you're important. A business owner and you don't have the same name as on the you know, front door, then she kind of felt a little funny about it.
Well,
so.
A lot of times the woman takes the hyphen, but the man doesn't.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know. We talked about it. It made sense. And honestly, like, it's just a last name. Like, I don't really care.
Okay.
But yeah.
It's like Harley Davidson, mm-hmm. kind of, except that was two men.
Yeah.
In so this that's case, weird. It's two women.
Yeah. Two bitches. All right. So, well, anyways, yeah. So my story. Born and raised in Sweden, rode dirt bikes, started riding when I was nine. Mm-hmm. And I mean, winters in Sweden are kind of gnarly, so we did not ride a whole lot. But I moved here in 2010 to race like amateur stuff. And it was all on my own. Like I had a dream and I wanted to ride and race. And I made it, you know, did like the whole amateur scene, Loretta's, Mammoth, all that stuff. Did okay. And then moved up to pro and raced pro.
So you turned pro here, not in Sweden.
Correct. Yeah. Okay. I 9 amateur championships. Like, I did all right. One Mammoth, one like the Ponca Cities and World Minis and stuff. But it was all like C class, you know, and then moved up to B, did all right, and then got my points and did some Supercross. But it was difficult, definitely doing like on your own. So at one point, grew up a little bit and figured it's kind of difficult. So started FCP since kind of quitting the dream of racing pro, started making parts and now we have parts on pro's bikes. So it's almost like, you know, I'm still in it.
Yeah. Where in Sweden were you from?
So I grew up in a little town called Ulricehamn, which is like an hour from Gothenburg. But we did move to Stockholm when I was 15. So like as far as when I departed, I did move from Stockholm and my mom still lives there. So I still have a lot of roots in Sweden.
So when I worked at Transworld Motocross, I went to the Uddevalla GP.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Ryan Cooley and I went and we were just like, oh, dude, you know, as Americans, we think of, I think Swedish meatballs, I think IKEA, but then, you know, there's the Swedish bikini team, right?
Yeah.
And so we're like, dude, the chicks are going to be unreal here. We didn't see one good-looking girl while we were there.
And then we didn't see one blonde. They're all brunette.
Yeah, yeah.
But, I mean, I know they exist because you see them in, you know, magazines and TV and stuff. But, yeah. Yeah, it was quite a trip for us. We had a great time.
Yeah.
Ate a lot of really good food. But it was funny, the last day we were there, I was like, I went to this restaurant. I go, hey, all right, I've had great Indian food. I've had great Thai food, French food, and, like, German food here. But, like, serve me a traditional Swedish meal.
Mm-hmm.
Anything you want, as long as it's not shellfish, because I'm allergic. Dude, did I tell you this story yet? You
know
what the lady brought me?
No.
She brought me a freaking hot dog with mashed potatoes on top.
Oh, okay, yeah. Yeah, and I okay.
go, what is this? And she's like, this is a traditional Swedish, is it comfort food or something?
Yeah,
or?
I guess, yeah. But yeah, kind of like they put like shrimp salad on hot dogs too. So I was really? Like, yeah, if you would have been like, oh, you know, I'm not allergic to shellfish, yeah. they would have given you like some
I mean, it was good, but I mean, I thought I was going to get some crazy like.
Yeah, like five course, like something fancy.
Yeah, or like some lamb chop or something. Mm-hmm. I don't know. She brought me a hot dog with mashed potatoes on it. But, yeah, and then for a while, the corporate owners of Transworld were based in Sweden, too.
Oh, really?
So we had this heavy Swedish influence and, like, big management meetings in Sweden. I always passed, you know.
But, oh, okay.
But yeah.
That's cool. Yeah, I mean, Uddevalla, that's not very far from where I grew up. Like, it's all on the, you know, West Coast or whatever. And I think that, like, the track I grew up at, it used to be, like a GP track, like way back in the day, you know, like I guess like 70s maybe, but yeah, it's Sweden's cool. I miss it. You know, it's a nice, definitely a nice place to like grow up. Yeah. So I do miss
it. How common is motocross there? How popular is it?
You know, it's for me, it's kind of hard to tell now because I've been here for so long, but not at like here, you know, and to like the country's pretty, you know, green. So as far as like motorsports in general, like they don't really, you know, they kind of frown upon it a little bit, I guess. So yeah, it's not as common, but when you're in it, I mean, there's tracks everywhere.
Yeah.
It's just maybe a little bit more hush hush or something. I don't know, but yeah.
Is it public tracks or like?
Yeah, they're public. And they're kind of, it's different. And again, it might've changed now, but they're open on like weekdays, like after school. And it's not like, they're not privately owned. So no one really like grooms them like they do here. So they're, I mean, it's kind of like what everybody talks about Europe is just the tracks are like
rough.
Yeah. Just crappier. Just, yeah. You know, so
what's the big popular thing in Sweden then?
Like soccer.
Soccer.
Yeah. Soccer and ice hockey. Yeah. Okay. Everybody, like if you're, you know, as a kid, everybody plays soccer at one point, and then in the winter you do play hockey or some kind of, you know, skiing or something. So I did all that.
So how did you end up in the States? Is just because this is the hotbed for motocross?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, like I wanted to race like in America. So I just kind of found a way to make it happen, honestly. I guess I've always been a pretty driven person. So one day I was just like, I'm done. Like, I don't want to be here anymore. So packed my bags and came here and started racing.
So how did you fund all that? Like, were your parents wealthy or did you save your
I had some money saved up and I did everything on the cheap. But, you know, I had a part-time job here too. I worked for a guy, Pete Vitrano over at Motoman Distributing.
Oh, yeah.
So we sold like, you know, tires and we were the
TMs.
The TM importer for a while. Mm-hmm. Yeah. When that was happening, I was working there like 3 to 4 days a week. So it was maybe a little more than part-time, but it was quite a bit. So.
And why did you choose Southern California to base yourself?
Well, I mean, that is because still like the Mecca, right?
Yeah.
Well, we lost a bunch of tracks, you know, in the recent years, but as far as 2010, you know, 11, 12, 13, this was the place to be. Uh-huh. So, yeah.
So you landed here. Did you know anyone? You just...
Not a single soul.
You just showed up and...
Yeah. I rented a room from Mike Young from Big Gun.
Okay.
And
what year was that?
2010.
Okay.
I came here in 2009 on one of those like motocross vacation programs where I was here for like a 3 month stint, and I got my feet wet. You know, kind of like saw the tracks, like, you know, understood how things were, and I you know, made some friends at that point, and that's how I was able to come back for like a longer stay.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, as far as like actually having family or like friends, like no.
Yeah. Okay. So the next year you came, moved here. What was the process? It's just rent an apartment or find a place to stay, rent a room?
There was rent a room. Yeah, I bought like a Astro van and just bought dirt bikes. I had like Yamahas at the time. Uh-huh. But I just bought a bunch of stuff, you know, and then, started riding and racing. And then as I even came here just to like do like the local stuff, I almost didn't even understand what amateur nationals were until I like, again, go into the track and I started doing pretty well. And then I, you know, made friends with some of the other kids that were, you know, aspiring pros. So they kind of taught me how to, you know, like show me the ropes, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. So how long were you here before you said, I need to
like get a job? Oh, well, honestly, when I got here, I broke my ankle really bad. Like, yeah, had a big old surgery, like 3 weeks into my stay.
No way.
Yeah. So.
So did you have like international traveler's insurance?
Yeah.
Oh, you did.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So that kind of saved me. Cause it was like 13 screws and two plates. Like it was a bad ankle surgery, and I've had multiple surgeries on it since. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so I was kind of like laid up on the couch for like 6 or 7 months. So I got a job like kind of right away, cause I was just going stir crazy, just, you know, watching TV. So, but yeah, I just always was able to do a little bit of work here and there and, you know, still get to ride and race. So that's all I really cared about. I didn't need to like make money to buy stuff, just as far as I could pay for gas and, you know, Del Taco, I was happy.
Took that training nutrition real seriously.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I was 19 and 20. So like, yeah, I didn't really know much.
Yeah. When you first got here, then what was your like favorite thing about being in the US, and what did you miss most about Sweden?
I mean, the weather, right? Like weather and to like the tracks, just the prep and how professional everything was really cool. As far as missing anything from home, I don't think I missed anything for years, you know, because I was just having so much fun here. But like these days, like, yeah, I do miss like the seasons, you know, and I miss not being in such a crowded, congested area anymore. Mm-hmm. So,
Like, do you miss your family? I mean, like, how big of an immediate family did you have? Were you only child?
Or? No, I got two siblings. I got a sister and a brother. I did miss them, but at the same time, like, I was so focused the whole time on like wanting to be a pro. You kind of like just shove all that stuff to the side. Mm-hmm. But we're really close. Like, we speak on the phone and FaceTime like multiple times a week. Yeah. And then like now too, like, and now I miss them a lot more. You know, I'm 30, I'll be 35. So now I wish I did have my family close here. But at the same time, my sister lives in Berlin. She's doing her thing. My brother lives in Poland. So like, we're all kind of scattered. So even like when people ask me, like, hey, do you want to go home? And it's like, well, what is home? Like, everybody's all over the place. So, home is here now.
Are your parents still alive?
Yeah, they're alive. They're divorced. But yeah, they're still around. Yeah. My mom's the only one that still lives in Sweden.
So, oh, wow.
Yeah. But they're, you know, we'll see. I mean, they're starting to be in the age of like retirement. So you never know where life takes you. So yeah.
Does your family ever come visit you in the States?
Oh yeah. Many times. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. They would come like at least once a year. And then my wedding was just last year. So that was like the first time in, I don't know.
Everyone was together.
Yeah. It was a long time, especially because mom and dad were divorced. So yeah. Uh-huh. But it was nice seeing everybody all at the same time.
What did your father think of you with this hyphenated last name? Did you lie and say that's how everyone does it in the US?
Well, actually, so even my sister kept her last name and her husband kept his last name. Mm-hmm. And that's like normal in Germany, I guess, you know. Okay. So I don't know, like, I think, yeah, I don't think my parents just kind of don't care, same thing, like, it's like, you know, different times.
So do you have a jersey for riding yet with this hyphenated?
I do not, no, huh? But I need one. Yeah, I should get one. Oh, man. But, you know, at the same time, if we have a kid and I name it Frankie, it'll be FCP.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Okay, so you're at Moto Man.
Mm-hmm.
Where does it go from there work-wise?
Work-wise? I worked there for a long time. And then at one point, I just kind of like wanted to do my own thing. Mm-hmm. And then I was like working on dirt bikes, like out of my garage, and really like getting heavy into like, you know, just framing bikes and doing all that. I almost feel like it's the same story for a lot of pros, you know, mm-hmm. or a lot of people that kind of quit riding or whatever. So I was doing a bunch of stuff out of the garage. And then, you know, made some friends in the industry. I was doing some testing for Dirt Bike Magazine and stuff.
Yeah, I remember that.
So that's kind of what happened after Moto Man. And then, yeah, shortly after that was FCP time.
Mm-hmm. Okay, engine mounts.
Mm-hmm.
That was like the big buzzword for a couple of years, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like,
yeah.
Everybody's just like, oh, dude, I can't even ride that bike unless I get some engine mounts.
Yeah.
Where does the idea for aftermarket engine mounts come from?
I don't know where it comes from as far as, you know, like the actual idea, but it's been done for years. You know, it's just a way to manipulate the chassis. And again, that's kind of where the, you know, being around for so long and being racing on a higher level and having friends in the industry, race teams have been doing engine mounts for a long time. Mm-hmm. And as far as what we do, like kind of our key to success is just using titanium so much. Titanium has like a certain feel. But yeah, there's other companies doing, you know, like carbon fiber or whatever. And, you know, there's other people doing engine mounts. It's done, been done before, and especially like on a professional, like factory level. I mean, they go through everything, mm-hmm. every single nut and bolt.
The first thing I ever heard similar to that mm-hmm. effect was CR250 when Ricky was racing still.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was pretty good friends with Chad Watts. I remember Chad was like, you want to make your bike turn better? Take out the front engine mount bolt.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes, take it and go to McFadendale and get the next size up in an American equivalent, you know, a little bit bigger.
Yeah.
And put it in there and your bike will turn better. And he's all, the hole's big enough to accept it. You don't have to drill anything or any of that.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, man.
And no way, yeah.
I went and did it, and I was like, holy cow, you know, the front end feels better.
Yeah.
And I remember I would tell people, and they don't believe, like, you're crazy. You know, like yeah. His friend Dave Aropkin, I used to tell him, oh, dude, I did this. And he's like, yeah, right. But, but yeah, so then there's that. And then, you know, for years they always said there was like Honda would drill a hole in the inside of their
mm-hmm.
their frame to, mm-hmm. to allow for a little bit more flex or something. But,
yeah.
How do you develop this stuff? Is it just trial and error? Are you just taking a shot in the dark? Like, I mean, like, who was I saw this guy at the track there that I've known for a while. And he had a Honda and he drilled a hole in his engine hanger.
Yeah.
And I go, oh. And he goes, oh, yeah, I've just always done that because it makes the bike do this or that. But, like, but you, I mean, you know, obviously there's no engineering degree or whatever, but, like, is it just – you have an idea and you try something and you go ride it and see if it works and then you know what it does? Or is it like, there's always a common theme in, you know, thicknesses or
shapes? So basically, I mean, to do a good job, like basically when the new bike comes out, that's what it helps to advertise with magazines and get some insider information from race teams and stuff. I mean, every year you can find out what, you know, like an OEM brand ended up doing to their bike. You know, like when Honda was it 2017 through 19 was like a really stiff chassis, and then they advertised like, hey, our new chassis for 2021 I think was 20% softer, like something crazy, right? Mm-hmm. So obviously hearing that, hey, these guys went softer this year, then we kind of go in and look at the actual engine mount and look, you know, see what material they're using. You know, if they're using a steel that is really thick, then obviously the stiff one. If it's thin, then it's soft. If you're using aluminum, they're going for a certain feel. And then we'll make some prototype parts that are, you know, very stiff in one direction, very soft, and kind of play around with it a little bit. But like you said too, like, you know, I'm not an engineer, but I have an engineer working for me, and mm-hmm. there are like softwares where you can use to kind of sketch some stuff and get a general idea of how to make a part perform. Mm-hmm. But yeah, and then it's just like track testing, like anything. Like, you can make anything look good on the computer, but until a rider tells you he's happy, then, you know, it's a different ball game.
Yeah. You said you work primarily with titanium or mm-hmm. exclusively?
No, it's we do all tie typically in the front, and then aluminum in the top. And it's mainly like a little bit of cost, but also like it just seems to really work well to have aluminum in the top. And then even like you were saying with the front engine mount bolt on the Honda, we try to go, generally we go stiffer in the front than stock.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of that has to do with like the feel. So when you make something pretty stiff in the front, you get a lot more feel and you're trying to eliminate some flex down there, where on the top side of the frame, we're trying to make it kind of dip into corners better. So going a little bit softer is, I, you know, kind of what we do over there. But I've also seen kind of people, because we have holes in our parts, you know, in certain locations, and a lot of people will drill out their stock stuff, think like, oh, this is the way you do it. And when I see somebody drill out their front engine mount, I'm just shaking my head, because they're doing like the opposite of what we're doing. So don't do that.
Stiffer, softer then.
Yes. Yeah.
What is the property of titanium that makes it better? Is it more rigid? It is more rigid.
It's tough. It's a tough material. So it is stiff, but it's also tough, and it just has like a certain dampening feel. And, you know, how long have you been riding bicycles for? Like forever and a day, or
9 years?
Oh, okay. So, I mean, if you were to talk to like a old timer road bike, you know, cyclist, they would tell you that riding a titanium frame, which, I mean, they're not common anymore, like everybody does carbon, but a tie frame is like riding on a marshmallow. Like, it's really comfortable. So it absorbs impact pretty uniquely, I guess.
Mm-hmm. So is there a downside to the material? Like, is it more brittle?
No.
Does it break? Or
no, it doesn't break. I mean, anything can break, but, you know, ties, it's almost as, it's like similar stiffness and as far as, you know, not breaking, it's like steel. Mm-hmm. And steel is strong, right? But but the toughness is like the word I'm trying to use. It's just, it has a certain, like, and to, like, titanium won't really, it depends on how you look at it, but the, like, there's titanium, and then there's titanium alloy, and, you know, there's different grades of titanium, and we're using a certain grade, and the grade we're using, it won't flex. Okay. It won't move, and then it'll just crack. So it is a very stiff part, where if you had like a pure titanium, it's pretty soft, and it would, you know, you could bend it and, you know, form it back and forth without it breaking. But yeah, the tie we're using, like, it won't budge, and then it'll just snap. So where a stock steel mount, you could bend it and then bend it back. So again, tie has a certain feel.
Okay, what about, like, stock engine mounts are aluminum, right?
Mm-hmm.
So are they cast or forged?
Depends on the brand, you know.
Okay, so there's both.
Yeah,
out there.
Yeah.
Okay, so what is the property of an aluminum upper hanger versus the stock one? Like, because yours are billet aluminum, right?
Correct. Yeah. Yeah. Ours
billet is always stiffer.
It's always it's often stiffer than whatever the stock one is. But, you know, we're changing the thicknesses too. And a lot of times we'll go thinner. So, we're using maybe like a stronger material, but we'll go thinner. And then placing a hole in a certain, you know, spot will make it flex more than a stock one. Mm-hmm. You know, so, but yeah, when it comes to like how we design our stuff, like, typically we do try to make the top flex more. Mm-hmm. So,
do you have ever like an option, say, 2024? KX450, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is it one set of front and top?
Yeah.
Or is there, this one is stiffer, or this one's flexier?
Like, no, we make one kit per bike.
Okay.
Yeah. But that's where, like, our R&D, like, we spend way more time maybe than other people, just like trying to perfect something. And then you're able to change like the torque settings a little bit to get, like, you know, go a certain direction. That's kind of how we've been modeling our product. But it's funny you would say the Cowie, because, you know, the new Cowie 450, they have like different hole locations where you could put the engine mount. So we've been playing around with that quite a bit. And we have it figured out now too, or it'll be in production real soon. But yeah, we just do a bunch of R&D. You know, we try, you know, this design, this, you know, on the Cowie, this hole placement, and then, yeah, different thicknesses, different size holes. But as far as the consumer, when you go on our website, there's one kit for your bike, and odds of you being happy are great.
That's another thing. When you mentioned torque settings, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's funny because, like, the first time I really became aware of, like, torque settings making bikes handle differently was when Chad Reed was on Team Cowie, and Nick Way was there too. And they were like, I remember Chad liked his forks and his pinch bolts torqued a certain way, but the team wanted it this way, and he would change it. And it was just this big internal battle, right?
Yeah.
But, like, that really is a factor that affects the way your bike handles.
Yeah.
So in addition to testing your mounts, are you testing torque settings, how tight you're putting stuff too?
Yeah, yeah.
And so do your mounts come with suggestions? Like if this is what we recommend, but if you feel this, do this or that?
We don't have like the option. But yeah, when you buy this stuff, like we have instructions, we have torque settings that we recommend for that bike. Mm-hmm. And whenever people like reach out, kind of ask like, hey, you know, I really like your product, but I wish it was doing this more. Mm-hmm. Then we'll respond with like, hey, try this torque setting. But at the same time, you know, when you're changing torque settings, you just only have like a couple of percent you can play with, you know? So if you start going super loose on stuff, like, you know, you could initially just break apart, you know? So we don't screw around too much with it. Just minor.
Yeah. The whole air fork revolution, you know, when it first happened, I was like, wow, air forks. And I was talking to my brother about it, you know, like, and he said air forks were born out of not necessarily technology, but out of demands for more affordable components.
Yeah.
And but my brother says, it is a great technology at the highest levels for them to adjust something so quick.
Yeah.
My best story about air forks is, you know, when the Cowie came out with the first KYB PSF1 air fork, Donnie Wilson, my partner in SML, he had a personal or a Cowie that they loaned him or something. But he rode my bike and he goes, whoa, your bike handles so much better than mine. I got to send it to Enzo too. And I go, I have stock still.
Uh-huh.
And I go, what do you have your air pressure set at? And he goes, huh? Okay, so like right there is a perfect scenario, right? There's guys, there's probably a larger percentage than most people admit that go and ride their bike, they don't check their air pressure on their tires, let alone their forks, right?
Yeah.
Like take our numbnuts buddy Scrub Daddy, for instance, right? He's got our Husky test bike right now. We gave it to him with a brand new fork pump. And the other day at Kauia, mind you, he's had it for like at least 2 months. He's like looking at it. He's like, this thing is broken. It don't even. But you know, like a digital fork pump comes with that little piece of plastic you got to pull out to activate the battery. So he's never checked his fork pressure in 2 months. Yeah. He's checking it for the first time because I told him to check it.
Okay, yeah.
So, I mean, there's that, right? Does the average motocross guy even own a torque wrench to, like, mess with this stuff?
I don't think so. I think, I mean, I don't know. It seems like, you know, lately I do feel like technology is getting better.
Yeah.
And I think kind of like you're saying that, you know, engine mounts was like the craze, like, you know, 3-4 years ago. The last, I kind of feel like whenever FCP got formed, like the word chassis has been like thrown around so much more, and so much more emphasis is put on chassis, on, you know, the different brands and how they're working on it constantly. So I do feel like the racer does have a torque wrench. You know, it might be like a cheaper one from Harbor Freight or something, but maybe, you know, back in the day, I don't think anybody had a torque wrench, but now it is kind of getting a lot more popular. The people are taking it maybe more serious, or also like just understanding how much of a difference it makes. So I would say it's getting there.
Yeah. Okay. You know, when everyone buys a brand new bike, first thing they do is buy a pipe, right? Yeah. And in this day and age, bikes with the apps that you could change, a pipe isn't always necessary, and sometimes it's not always better.
Yeah.
You know, but where in the grand scheme of things, order of importance, do you see your parts?
Well, to me, obviously, it was like number one priority. Yeah, but, well, obviously, but, yeah. You, but like, no, in all honesty, if you get a brand new bike, a lot of people, I mean, if you're thinking about doing some kind of suspension work, I would kind of urge you to try the engine mounts maybe before then, just to see if it's, you know, a cheaper and, you know, quicker way to see if you can improve the bike. Because like you're saying, like the suspension these days, even the stock stuff, it's pretty good.
Yeah. So, and that's another thing too, is like when people like will get a bike and they send it out
right
before
away.
They even ride it, right? Yeah. Well, yes, if they're a pro that's going to tax the suspension more than, you know, it's set up for, or outside above or below the target weight range?
Correct.
Yes,
yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
Or if the bike, the model has a glaring flaw,
yes.
right?
Yeah.
But most people don't, explore the range of adjustability,
mm-hmm.
and really take time to learn what the clickers do. They just send it out.
Yeah.
Like, so many people that send their suspension out, they probably just set the sag, or maybe they don't set the sag, but like they get it back and they go, it's magic.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they don't still mess around with it, you know?
Yeah. Like, yeah. And that's common. But yeah, I do feel like just, you know, brand new bike, when you put, you know, whatever, 10 hours on it, that's when it's broken. Right. Mm-hmm. And then if you're, like you're saying, if you're in, you're heavy to where you need springs, or you're, you know, a little bit lighter rider where you need springs, you typically send stuff out. But yeah, I mean, like you're saying too, with pipes and stuff, a lot of pipes, no matter what, they're going to be a lot lighter than the stock one.
Mm-hmm.
So you are getting that, at least when you're purchasing that. But yeah, the engine mounts are getting, yeah, more popular. And even like you were saying with, you know, like the stock stuff is pretty good. OEMs are kind of changing their engine mounts lately as well.
Yeah, like the Cali comes with that.
Like two an option, mounts and yeah.
Optional accessory.
Yeah, yeah. So it's kind of neat to see where we've taken this so far. I mean, it's been a few years since we started, and now seeing GasGas and KTM Group kind of doing, they have options, and they also have, like, you know, hollowed out ones, if you will. And like you're saying with the Cowie having options and stuff, it's kind of pretty mm-hmm. cool.
The Austrian bikes, they don't have lower engine mounts, just bolt straight through the frame.
Correct, yeah.
So that's why you have a different bolt, right?
Yeah.
But like, what produces a bigger detectable difference? A different bolt or a different set of mounts?
Well, we can do more with mounts. So mm-hmm. a different bolt, you know, we could only go so big until it starts binding in the hole, right?
Yeah,
so with the Honda, you're saying that there is room without drilling out the frame or, like, you know, honing out the motor.
Mm-hmm.
So we can do more with a engine mount, and especially the only one we've had difficulties is with like the Honda. And the Honda, you can only do so much because the it's wedged in between the frame and the engine, so you can't really go much thicker, where all the other bikes, it's just mounted on the outside,
mm-hmm.
so you can change the thickness quite a bit.
What is your best selling part?
The KTMs.
Yeah. Well, there's more KTMs.
Yeah.
Gas Huskies than anything.
Yeah. So there's a lot of bikes. And then luckily too, the 250F, 350F and 450, they all utilize the same part. So that's a high one, but Honda and Cowie, like they've definitely been popular.
What needs it the most?
See, that's a hard one to needs is a weird word.
In your opinion, as a test rider,
which
bike is the most flawed and needs help?
See, I don't want to use the word flawed either. I think the KTM does benefit a lot from an engine mount. You got one on your Husky.
Mm-hmm.
But I haven't spent any time on the Cowie 450, so I don't know how that bike feels. But the Yamahas, I do really, really like mm-hmm. the feel that our product does, like, provide that bike with. So yeah, Honda or the Yamaha 250F, I spent some time on, and then yeah, like the Yamaha 450 is like a top seller for sure.
Mm-hmm. Your parts come in like different finishes, right? Like colors.
Yeah, yeah.
It's either brown mag looking or rainbow bright.
So the rainbow stuff is the
oil slick.
And actually, I was kind of talking to a friend of mine saying that it's not rainbow because there's no yellow in it. For it to be okay. But yeah, the tie dyeing, that's all so basically like the rainbow stuff is titanium, and then the bronze, like brown color, aluminum. Those are aluminum parts.
Yeah.
And that's the only colors we offer. So if it's aluminum, it's brown.
Okay.
And then the tie is the rainbow.
What's the biggest pain in the butt piece to make? Is it the top KTM mount, because it has the threads in it?
Yeah.
Are you still doing the separate piece like I have on my bike?
Yeah, I'm doing that. Yeah. Because that's the performance thing. Honestly, like the KTM stuff it's complicated to make. Like it's got a different, you know, planes basically. It's got different shapes in it. Where like a, you know, a cow is going to have like one bend in it. It's no big deal. So mm-hmm. yeah, everything that's, you know, the KTM like starts out like a block this big. So it's a really long machining time. But
mm-hmm.
It's still aluminum, so it's easy. Where mm-hmm. like anything tie is just a pain in the butt, no matter what.
Where do you source your tie from? Is that a hard raw material to get hold of?
Yeah, it's not difficult. I mean, if you have the right people, yeah, it's not that big of a deal. But yeah, it's all you know, we buy it from our source.
Mm-hmm. It's from the hills of Uddevalla.
No, it's nothing's made in Sweden, I guess. It's all local here. Like, you know, we have machine shops we deal. We still outsource a lot. But again, real soon, I'm hoping to do a lot more in-house. So we've been growing quite a bit.
What would be the next thing FCP could possibly branch into? Have you explored something or dreamed about something?
Yeah. I had a pretty kind of cool idea last year. We're coming out with a new product. It is a chassis part. We kind of talked about a little bit here and there, but like nothing like official. So I'll let you know like after we're done with this, but it's pretty neat. I think we're about, I don't know, 6 weeks away from launching it, and we'll launch it for all the bikes all at once. And it is, again, something that racing has been doing forever. It's a adjustable part where you can change the feel of your bike, and it's going to be pretty cool.
Cool. I don't have any more questions.
No?
I mean, not that are suitable for the podcast. FCP has been in business how long now? Like
2018. Yeah. So
5 years?
Yeah.
A little okay. More. Things good. Business is like, you know, whenever you launch your own business, right? You're like, oh man,
it's scary.
I gotta make it. Or yeah. Just get it. Like, do you have that feeling now? Like, I've made it. I'm solid. Business is here.
I don't think I'll ever have the feeling like, hey, I made it. You know.
Well, but I mean, your business is established.
Yeah, it's established. But you still have fear of like, oh, are we screwing up? Are we, you know, like kind of rushing things? Or, you know, like you'll always have that little bit of like fear, I guess, which is good. But no, it's been cool seeing where it's gone. Because, yeah, it started like in the garage. And I remember going to like a REM, you know, Glen Helen, that used to race all the time. And I meet up with some of the, you know, industry people that, you know, had businesses, and I would walk up, and I remember like my first little interview I had, like I had a white t-shirt on with like a FCP sticker on it. You know what I mean? Like I didn't even have shirts made yet. You know, it's like starting from there and making it to what it is today. Like we sponsor a bunch of teams in Supercross and Motocross and MXGP. We sell worldwide. Like it's pretty cool. We got dealers like in the US, we have them in Europe. It's pretty sweet.
Is there a bigger market in big bikes or little bikes? Because I know that you won titles with Liam Olaf.
At Loretta's, yeah.
So, I mean, are the mini bikes, because kids usually can't really offer much feedback.
Yeah.
But I mean, how is it developing for that, and how are sales for little bikes?
For mini bikes. So for the minis, we used to do like the KTM, you know, 85. And then we have the super mini for the KX. But what's kind of cool about that is, you know, maybe the average, you know, super mini kid won't feel that big of a difference, but it's the kids that are like really fast. And when you're going like the speeds these kids are going on the super minis, like they break all the time. And those, the like intended use for a super mini is not jumping, you know, supercross triples, but they are. So all of our parts there, like they're pretty stiff because we're trying to help those bikes flex less. So it's almost, you know, kind of like, I don't want to say easy to make, but yeah, like we made parts that are like really stiff for the super minis because the kids break just everything. So yeah, it's picking up, you know, but the Yamaha 85 doesn't even have a head stay, you know, so like we can't really make anything for that bike.
Yeah.
But yeah, the super mini KTM and KX, you know, 112, we're selling parts for those too.
So. Yeah. What about the Suron craze? Is there engine mounts on those?
I haven't really looked at them, but it is like getting out of control with how popular those things are getting.
Those, and like, is there something you could manufacture for a STACYC?
Yeah. Yeah. And like one of these days when I have a little bit more time on my hands, like maybe I will look into doing that. But for now, we're still just focused on like our core, like motocross. Like we do some dual sports stuff, you know, and then kind of like the super mini stuff was maybe a year or two ago that we started dipping our, you know, toes with. But yeah, like the e-bike stuff, I'm sure there's something we could make, but it's not kind of my passion either. I just want to make stuff just to make stuff. Absolutely. Like we're trying to make parts that, you know, help performance. So
do your parts cross over well into off-road competitions?
Yeah. Yeah, we have a lot of like work series and NGPC and like GNCC, like that's really taken off for us.
Yeah.
And we even have like the World Enduro Championship. We have guys using our parts there, and it is kind of funny seeing how different the setups are from like American off-road to European off-road. Mm-hmm. It's pretty interesting. So yeah, we're having a lot of success over there too.
Okay, so you've had sales around the globe then.
Mm-hmm.
Does it give you a special feeling when you get an order from Sweden?
I do, yeah. That, it's always fun too. And a couple of times, like, people reach out on Instagram, and I'll just respond in Swedish sometimes, you know, and they're like, oh, what the hell?
That's cool.
But what's really cool is when we get, like, an order from, like, Japan.
Mm-hmm.
Because then you're just like, oh, wow. Like, you know, as far as knowing how to build parts for motorcycles, like, Japan's up there, right? Mm. So when you get Japanese sales, it's definitely special.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right on. Well, hey, man, thanks for coming in and share your story with us.
Absolutely.
Interested to, earlier you put some mounts on the YZ250F outside.
Mm-hmm.
So we're testing that on Wednesday, I think. So looking forward to spending some laps on that and feeling what your parts do.
Awesome.
So anyway, fcpracing.com. Check out Kris Coan-Palm's hyphenated products. In the meantime, get some graphics from factorybacking.com, 50% off for the rest of his anniversary year. Thanks for checking out the Midweek Podcast. Talk to you next time.
Factory Backing has been producing custom motocross graphics since 2004. At Factory Backing, they prioritize quality by using the finest vinyl materials available. Their competitive prices might seem surprising, but rest assured, they offer top-notch products specifically designed for motocross and the demands of dirt bike riders. Check them out at factorybacking.com. But act fast, as they are celebrating their 20th anniversary with a 50% off sale.